So let's talk about the scholarships here, okay? So this is a nice little slide that shows the scholarships, okay? Now, this slide I want to talk about in detail. So let's talk about the scholarship package, what it means. And this is only showing the tennis scholarships, and that's it, okay? When a scholarship package comes for a player, it's not just only tennis scholarship, okay? It's a combination of. So a college can look at the SAT score or the ACT score, mainly for American students. It can look at your GPA. It looks at your financials to see this financial need. There is also other areas like church scholarships, you know, other leadership-based scholarships, grants. There are several things that go into a scholarships. And of course, the tennis is one part of it, right? So I'm going to go through it in a little bit different way. I'm going to go with the women's first and the men's second. Okay, and here's the reason for it. So in the women's, it's a little bit different, especially for most of the Division I teams. Okay, not all. The fully funded Division I teams, they have 8 scholarships. Okay, what it means is there are 8 full scholarships. And there it's something called a headcount scholarship, which means a scholarship comes 100%. It covers tuition, books, room and board, and some incidentals nowadays, okay? But you cannot break a headcount scholarships into 2 or 3 parts. So you have to give it 100%, right? So typically, if a girl makes a team and is in top 8 and the school is fully funded, they are offered a full ride just from tennis, okay? So what happens in that case, they don't need any more scholarships, academic or anything else, even if they're eligible, right? Because you cannot get more than 100%. So tennis covers it all for them. So it's very, very different than the men's side, and I want to go through it. So, but that's only for the Division I, okay? So it's called the headcount scholarships. In the Division II and the other divisions, you know, what they have is called the equivalency scholarship. So let's talk about the Division II, right? On a fully funded D2 team, there are 6 full scholarships available, okay? But the unlike a Division I women's team, a fully funded D1 women's team, that 6 can be broken down into 12. They can do 50% for everybody. They can do 3 of them 100%, 1 10%. It completely depends on the coach, how they want to offer. So there's a little bit more flexibility from the coach's side about, you know, kind of divvying up the pot. So if female athlete gets 20%, say they're not great, but they're good, and they may not make the lineup the first year. So the coach brought him in and said, okay, you come in and I'm going to give you 20% athletic. But that doesn't mean the package is only 20%. That's where the athlete needs to work early in the process with the coach, with their financial aid division. And hopefully you guys know how to work with it, or your consultants know it. And you work with them to come up with the optimum package, right? They look at your academic, they look at your need-based and all that. And that girl who received 20% could end up becoming an 80% or even 100% player when all those things have been looked at very, very critically. So it's really, really important to understand how the total scholarship works, especially in a case when it's not on headcount scholarships. Now, going back to the women's D1 in the headcount, there's only 8, right? So the teams keep 12 many times. So what happens to the other 4? They cannot get an athletic scholarships because the 8 has already been given. So those players like the 9, 10, 11, 12, or, you know, some of those players, what they do is they come in with other type of money, right? Like the academic scholarships or need-based. And some of them may be just wealthy and just say, you know what, I want to participate in this team. Like I personally know players who'd love to go and play for North Carolina State because, you know, this is a phenomenal team. Like they just have, like, you know, Diana Schneider did so well in Australian Open Women's and she's going to play for them. So it's a great team. Some people want to just get a chance to play. And if they, you know, if they get in, they say, you know what, I don't even want to mess with the scholarships. Okay. So that's how the scholarship package works. Now I'm going to shift to the men's side. The men's side do not have any headcount. It's all equivalency scholarship across all the divisions. So if you look at a Division I, like any of these top colleges that you hear, right, from the Stanford to Florida, you know, like Florida, I mean, everybody knows now, right? Ben Shelton, look at the guy. He played for Florida first year. He was barely making the lineup. He was 6'7". He started playing, and then and he has never left the U.S., never played ITF, never left the U.S. till Australian Open. And obviously, you saw his results, how he did in Australia. So, I mean, so these teams are very, very good, right? But they, and they, everybody wants to play there, but they only have 4.5 tennis scholarships. So they divide that with the players that they keep in the team. You know, I think Florida keeps about 12. So to divide that in that team base, right? But the players can get the other money as well. And Florida is a public institution. It's a state institution. So the students coming from Florida, they also get in-state tuition, which means their tuition is less. So that helps also for them. Obviously, doesn't apply to the foreigners and all that. But again, they get divided, right? The tennis money gets divided among many players, and then the players look for other source of funding. So that's why it's super important to start working early, target those teams, have a plan in place, and then go and work with the financial aid office in conjunction with the coach, knowing that you have a shot of being in the team, you know? And the same thing lies in the D2, NCAA, NAIA. Now, the one that I want to cover here is the D3s, NCAA Division III. Both for men and women, there's no athletic scholarships, zero. But the coaches are very creative, okay? So if the players have a need, financial need, or if they have like good academics, they do help you in working with financial aid to come up with some scholarships. So don't kind of knock it off because it's a D3. It also provides the money, it just does not provide you in the athletic banner. Okay. So this is a pretty important topic right here with the scholarships and the structure of it and how it works and all that. So I'm going to pause and see if anybody has any questions about the scholarships and the process. But because this is a good time for you to ask, because the more you know about it, it's going to help you, with your research.
Hey, Anirban, thank you for dragging up this important topic over this. I was looking for the same topic. I just have a query that I have a kid and for scholarship. Can you let me know what is the criteria of scholarship varies college to college?
So the criteria, okay, so let's talk about the criteria, right? So one is, let's look at the athletic side first, the tennis. So I think, Sanjay, you asked the question. So if you're looking at the athletic side, what do the coaches want at the end of the day? You know, the coaches may tell you all sorts of things. We want to build the player. We want to build the pro. But really, the coaches want the players to win as soon as possible when they come. Because the coaches, a lot of times their compensation truly depends on the performance, right? So they have an incentive to perform. Otherwise, you know, they get fired. So it's like almost like having a professional contract. So when they look at a player, they try to evaluate through UTR, through, you know, whatever rankings, WTN, doesn't matter, asking other people to find out, is this player going to make an impact in my team? Okay. If they are going to make an impact in my team, then they're interested. If they're not going to make an impact, but they think the potential is really high, sometimes they take a chance on it, but that's pretty much it. As far as the hopefully that answers your question, Sanjay, from an athletic side, because I have a couple of other questions that come up in the chat, and I think that talks in the academic. So let's look at those two questions, right? So I have a question from Hore. Please confirm, many D3 give scholarship based on academics. Can you talk about this? What is a good GPA to be considered a good student? And then Jenica asked, in a D3 college, would a coach know how much academic scholarship is possible? So the answer to that, I'm going to start with Jenica's answer. Yes, the coaches have a very good idea, especially if they're a seasoned coach, right? They have been in the college for a while. They know where the bodies are buried to be. So they obviously know, they have some pull within the financial aid and they help guide. So the coaches play a very, very critical role in this. The expectation is not for you or your consultant to just navigate this with financial aid yourself. If you are part of the team and the coach has an interest, the coach is going to help you. And your job is to keep communicating with the coach to understand what type of monies are going to be coming in, you know, how they're going to get in and things like that. Okay. These, Now, going back to the second question is, can you talk about what's a good GPA to be considered a good student? So that's like, I'm going to give you a consulting answer. It depends. It depends on the institution. If the kid is going to a D3 like an MIT, my guess would be they're looking at super elite athletes. I mean, super elite students coming in, right? Not necessarily super elite athletes. So probably I would say in there, you're looking at really high SAT score, probably a near perfect score, probably, you know, close to a 4.0 GPA. That would be my guess, right? If it's a very academic school, there are D3s, maybe there are not so academic. So it all depends on the university and what their particular structure is, right? So obviously the good grades cannot hurt, right? On anywhere you go. But these are all great questions in the early process. So what we do in our package is also one of the things is when people subscribe to our platform, we not only provide details about all these things, but also we give, you know, these questionnaires that they need to sort of ask at certain times. The questions you need to ask the college coaches, when do you ask and things like that. So these are some very important questions to ask the coaches, okay, about their own colleges, because it depends on college to college, what a good GPA is and, you know, what their criteria is.